Welcome to tonight, February 11th. So we are almost 1 month, or just over the 1 month, into the adventures of customs broker license exam. We have covered quite a bit. There is still quite a bit to cover, and some folks are even ahead of the game. So I had a question that came up earlier, either yesterday or the day before yesterday, or maybe even today, about one of the chapters which deals with intellectual property rights. And I kind of wanted to respond it in as a part of the class, because I think everyone will benefit from it. So the question relates to chapter, chapter 20. So we're talking about the volume 2, which is the black book, chapter 27, that deals with intellectual property rights. So within that chapter, I have talked extensively about various types of intellectual property rights, including the ones that deal with with trademarks, the ones that deal with copyrights, and the one that deal with patents. There is another type of intellectual property which I have not talked about. It's never tested on the custom license broker exam, and that deals with the trade secret. So in those videos, what I've done is I discussed something that is so-called the level rule. I think I have it that up on the picture. So the question was is that it's kind of confusing and kind of difficult to understand. So I know that person who asked me is ahead of a game, which is great. I hope that they're able to catch up with all the other stuff that I assign. But having said that, what's the deal with the IPR? So let me make a quick note on the trademarks, because it is a big deal. It is something which we see as a part of the customs news all the time, where customs seizes stuff on a regular basis. And this is something that I think deserves a brief mention of what's going on. So the Lever Brothers, this is a company that made history because it was a forerunner of the intellectual property rights, specifically trademarks, that affected the world of customs and got us to where we were, we are today, from back where we were in the late 80s, early 90s. So again, as a reminder, if you haven't read the chapter, that's fine. Usually I leave it for later, the IPR, the intellectual property rights stuff, but we'll say a few words here. So remember, three types of property rights. So we have trademark, we have patents, and we have copyrights. Those stem from the different sources of law, and they are being afforded different protections. So in here, in this particular case, I'm talking about the trademark protection, which is most common type of the protection being utilized in the world of customs, and therefore being asked in the world of customs license broker exam. So Lever Brothers, many of you go to the store, but you buy soap, detergents, and all that other stuff, and some of you may notice that there is a brand out there which belongs to Lever Company. So the latest brand that I've seen when I went to the store was, I think, Lever 2000 brand. So that's a trademark. made by the company which is falls within the trademark law. So what's the deal? Why did Lever Brothers, why did they make history here with respect to the trademark protection? So we of course the history comes within our view as a part of the case law. So those of you who are in the chat, I just dropped the link to that particular case. This is the appellate level case going back to 1993, and it talks about the soap products imported by Lever Brothers company. And no, I'm sorry, let me rewind that. So Lever Brothers have two, I think it's easier if I start writing stuff out. Okay, so that's a little weird because I was hoping it will. Okay, so sorry, folks, the cam is acting funny because I should be in the cam and the cam is not showing that I'm part of it. I think now it's showing. All right, so everyone, so basically the other camera was kind of playing funny with me. Pulled that invisible man part where I should be there and I'm not. So now, let me see. Now I should be in there. So if anyone cannot see me, please let me know. So going to the Lever Brothers adventures. What we have? So we have one company, Lever Brothers, right? And it's a multinational company. In this case, we're concerned with the U.S. portion of their product distribution and with the United Kingdom portion of their distribution. They all have they all have this brand protection. And this particular brand protection relates to their Sunlight brand. So they have Sunlight brand. Yes, Sunlight. Actually spelled it correctly. Because those modern trademarks, they misspell the names. It would be like, instead of Sunlight, they would say something like Sunlight. Or sunlight, something like this, which is totally wrong from the grammatical perspective. But anyway, so they have those products under the brand of trademark. So brand and a trademark they are synonymous. They are synonymous, meaning that they're one of the same. So under the brand or trademark sunlight. Okay, so what happens here? So you have a Sunlight brand in US and you have Sunlight brand in UK. Now, what's the problem with that? Well, so far so good, but the issue is the Lever Brothers, they did the research and they said, you know what? The UK folks in the United Kingdom, they like it a little different. They would like to have different type of ingredients added within their soap or detergent product. Whereas United States people, they also have their different consumer tastes. So the formulation of the Sunlight product in the United States is different than the Sunlight product in the United Kingdom. Therefore, because we treat them as a separate markets. So some crafty people which are for entrepreneurship and for arbitrage, what they do is they buy the Sunlight product in the UK, and perhaps because of the exchange rate, perhaps because of some other reasons, they bring it into the United States. They purchase it legally, so this is a legal purchase. But the problem is over here, you have consumers buying the Sunlight product, the US consumers buying the Sunlight product, which is tailored to UK consumers, and because of that, you are kind of tarnishing the US consumer expectations. At least that's what the Lever Brothers attorneys argued. So the question is, the question goes out, what should we do? The position of customs was like, okay, listen, this is an actual trademark. They didn't manufacture it or make it a fake trademark. This is actual product. They paid money for it. They are free to do whatever you want. So let's say I purchase this precise V5 ballpoint pen. So I have this pen. Or how about this? I have this is a just better. So I have this Expo marker, right? So this Expo marker, Expo is a registered trademark. So my question is, I paid for it, I own it, I may even have a receipt somewhere. In fact, I do have a receipt because I got it over off the Amazon, I think. So there is a digital record of the transaction. So the question is, if this is my property, I should be free to do with it whatever I want. Let's say I don't like this marker because it's just not doesn't fit comfortably within my hand. So can I throw this away? Yes. Can I destroy it? Yes. Can I cut it up? Yes. Can I throw it in the fire? Yes. Can I give it to someone? Let's say I give it to, let's say, Svetlana because I think she's a amazing learner. So I'll just give it to her because she deserves this and it may improve her level of studying, let's say, in my subjective opinion. So, okay, I'm free to do that, right? Okay, then who is to tell me that I cannot put it in my pocket and go to the United Kingdom? I'm here in New York. Why can't I j put it in my pocket, j go to United Kingdom and sell that marker in the United Kingdom? So what's wrong with that? Or vice versa, why can't I go in the United Kingdom shop? Let's say while I wait those long airport lines, I buy this marker, I bring it into the United States, and US Customs says, "Oh, wait a minute, Expo, this is a registered trademark. So you're a bad person. You are violating the copyright. I mean, I'm sorry, the trademark laws. We're gonna take it away from you and seize it." So that's pretty much what. Where the fight comes out. Now, let's go back to our case. So in this case, you had legal importations. And by the way, this type of importation is called gray market. So if it was fake, let's say I made that marker in my basement, let's say, without any license for authorization, I slapped on Expo on it, and I just decided to sell it, let's say, on Amazon. This is bad, right? Because I had no authorization to do that. I may be using illegal chemicals, so this is something inappropriate. But what if it's a legal purchase? If it's a legal purchase, it's called a gray. If I manufacture the stuff in my basement, this is black, right? This is the black market stuff. So going back to this situation, so sunlight. UK lever makes different products, makes different manufacturing, let's say, techniques tailored to UK consumers. Even though they appear similar, inside the chemical formula is different. So someone who is very crafty and brings this stuff in under the gray market rubric, legally purchasing it in the United Kingdom, brings it over to United States and says, "Well, buy it." And people who buy it, and that's according to the lever United States, it tarnishes their reputation because someone goes like this, and they say, "Oh my God, this is totally different." If you read the case is quite long. You guys have the link, but if you read the case, you kind of have the attorneys introducing into the evidence the consumer tastes, and it shows that, for example, United Kingdom people, they like to take baths which are more like bubbly, they like to jump into the bathtub fill it up with water and have bubbles all over, and this is some kind of cool British thing. While in the United States, people don't bother with it; they just take a shower and move on. More efficient, business oriented, something like that. According to the findings. So basically, the idea is, okay, let US people do their quick shower stuff, let UK people take their bubbly bath without damaging our reputation. Fine, no problem. The court ended up making a holding saying, yeah, that sounds like kind of like what the trademark law is designed to protect, because trademark law, specifically we're talking about Lanham Act. So that's the trademark law. So, of course, whenever you do certain thing, whenever you enact something, you have to have a reason, right? If anytime you do something, you usually do it for the reason. So the reasons for the Lanham Act was to do this. So you, number one, is to is to help out the consumers. So let's say I come to CVS pharmacy, local CVS pharmacy, and I'm taking I wanna get a toothpaste because I run out of toothpaste. And let's say Colgate brand, I know because this is useful. It is something that I've been I'm familiar with. It is something that I like. So I run to the CVS shelf that has bunch of toothpaste, and I go and I say, oh, Colgate, all right. So Colgate, I'm gonna take it, and in 3 minutes I'm out. I pay for it. I'll do the self checkout thing, and I'm out. All right. What if I come in and I'm trying to see the product which is brandless? Let's say no Colgate. It just says toothpaste. How should I know? So the idea behind the legislature is to say, okay, so you create a trademark, you create a brand, and the brand is supposed to help out to ease my time searching for the product. So that's on the consumer side. On the producer side, on the trademark owner side, it is also beneficial to the society because it creates something called goodwill. So Colgate, I guess, what it is, P&G, Procter & Gamble. So Procter & Gamble is interested in maintaining its good name and its good reputation and its good quality. So it's going to invest in that Colgate brand. So that way, I stay faithful to that brand because I think it's a good company. I think it's a good stuff. So there is no reason for me to switch to something which is, let's say, Nature's Promise brand, let's say. So that's the idea, to help out the consumer, to help out the producer, to find the right balance. So in the customs world, because of this lever case, you now have the understanding saying, okay, so listen, if it's a gray market, we're going to apply what's known as a lever rule. And under the lever rule, we're going to say, okay, so we can prevent this misconception where we have the crafty people tarnishing the good reputation, goodwill of the lever that it invested so much in its Sunlight brand, right? But we have to have some kind of notice period. So the way it works out in customs, and I went out to the latest federal, well, customs bulletin publication. And by the way, the holding of this, let me go to the holding. So scroll down many pages. Okay. So yes. So importation of physically different trademark can be barred under the Lanham Act. There are more details to this, and again, this is not the intellectual property rights day, but we have these customs bulletins and decisions which I urge everyone to, kind of like if you read newspapers on daily basis, this stuff comes out Tuesday night, Wednesday morning. I just dropped the link down. Read this stuff. You'll learn a lot. Try to read it on a regular basis. You have stuff which is which kind of like with time they become more and more familiar. A lot of the stuff you skip because like gauge laboratories registration, but other stuff are interesting. So among this other stuff, what I wanted to share with you, since we're on a level roll, is this particular January 22nd, 2020, customs bulletin. So just over a year old, 1 year old. And let me drop down the link so you guys have this particular publication too as an example. So within this particular publication, what we do have is we have the notice stating that listen, pursuant to that Lever Brothers case that we just talked about, this particular trademark, BIC, so this is we're talking about the French brand, right? BIC is a French company. That has its own BIC and design mark registration. So that way we the BIC company, BIC company, will be able to prevent importations of legally purchased lighters, let's say, no, without authorization of BIC. They will be able to prevent importation to the United States. So that's the essence of the lever rule. Again, if you think of it as non-tariff barriers, if you think of it as something that restricts trade and commerce, you can, and you'll probably be right, but this is something which is which I think is very much relevant today. You must understand how, if you work for the company, how you can protect its interest, and if you're a consumer, how this stuff works out in the world of customs. And plus, customs examiners test you on this stuff, so just the theoretical knowledge would be helpful here as well. Well, in this case, the actual knowledge too, right? So we Now, if you've seen my homework assignments, we are coming into the world of entry. And entry is kind of like a very, very broad topic. It jumps all over the place. But essentially, we can narrow it down. If we try to, we can narrow it down to several parts of the Title 19 Code of Federal Regulations, Part 141, Part 142, and Part 143. This is where the bulk of the entry stuff is coming from. Also, you do have such things as various directives and various forms. So one that is the most popular one would be CBP Form 7501. So this is something which is consistently being tested in and out. The form itself and the instructions that follow. Another thing that is popular and which is part of the next exam which is coming up is the right to make entry. So this is also part of the general umbrella, which is which we need to be prepared for. And of course, the trick here is to be able to be versatile enough to be able to jump from one to another and relate one to another with ease. So let me just put it down. So under the entry rubric, we're dealing with 19 CFR parts 141, 143. By and large, there are exceptions, right? For example, mail entries. And we're talking about mostly the consumption entries too. We have entry summary. Summary, aka also known as CBP Form 7501, and we have a right to make entry directive. So those are the three kind of like umbrella items which we must do, and Abby, so 7501 form itself, the completion of the form, it's a separate chapter. We haven't gotten to it yet. We're just getting to this. So this 7501 can wait until next time. So, and the way I think we should do this is, what we're going to do is we are going to pick one of the CBP exams or several CBP exams next time, because the so far I had you go through the CFR most of the time, which it touch upon the entry summary part. Next week, you are going deep into the 7501. I'm gonna have you go through the chapters which are relevant, and I have several chapters because the way the book is designed, it doesn't focus on CBP Form 7501 in one chapter. It takes certain parts, so it takes date of entry, it takes what is called the submission of duties, it takes the port code, it takes the exchange rate, it takes the valuation. So I don't think I had you done the valuation part too. So all those items, once we cover them piece by piece, we'll be able to put together the puzzle. So please, at this point, all I'm asking is for you guys to really follow through the homework. Just follow through the chapter, look at the questions, watch the videos, because the videos, even though they are somewhat old, For the at least for the entry portion, they are still very much relevant. So that's why I'm not rewriting those whole chapters. Like, for example, I did with the transportation inbound merchandise and transit chapter, which changed a lot. So this is a point to get. But for our purposes of what we covered so far, we covered the right to make entry with I had you start on CBP form 7501's entry summary, certain parts. So duty submission, the taxes submission, I had you read through the breakout of the 7501, how much you can declare on it, where you what you the concept of ultimate consignee versus the importer of record, all this stuff. So at this point, we're still on what I think is a good way to summarize of all those chapters in a way, in a meaningful way, would be to really go through one of the exam questions, which really ties up a lot of the stuff that was and still is assigned for as a part of the homework for this week. So in this case, this would be the question 10 of the customs license broker exam. So compile the list of forms for us. Abiola, so you want to know something about the CBP forms? This book, volume 2, you open up to the very last chapter, not the flashcards, but chapter 32. It is called Commonly Tested Forms. It has compilation of forms which have been tested in the past. Some of them may not may have changed or no longer exist, but I still keep them there. So this book, last chapter, chapter 39, has a compilation. All right, so before I turn off and let you all guys enjoy the rest of the evening, let me go back to let me go back to that HTSUS question. Recall that we had issues with question 48. So we have, let me see if I can pull it up again. All right, so question 48. You may recall that we had that nylon man-made versus non-man-made dichotomy. Customs says this is no other. In other words, this is non-man-made. So it is answer choice C should apply without even giving us the reasons why. Subheading 11 is the one that I opt for because we clearly stated in the fact pattern that the commodity, the material component is a nylon. And according to the informed compliance publications, this is a man-made synthetic fiber. So this means that when you look at the exams and you look at and you practice, by the way, so this was a trick question because I have no answer for you. I think that I will not be in a position to open up the customs broker examiner's mind. Obviously, he did not provide the answer choice. And if I had time, I didn't get to this in time, but this would be one of the questions which definitely would be subject to appeal. But let's hope you will not be there. Let's hope you pass the first time. The idea here, the idea for this question, well, number one, it took us through the journey of the textiles. You all saw that YouTube video with this loud noise and my comments in a low volume. Sorry, I don't. I need to change my settings a little bit. I'll do that in the future. But what you need to use to the lesson that you need to take out of this particular question 48 is that sometimes the logic doesn't lead to the result that you can explain. And this can be attributable to something which I like to call a human factor, where we are all human beings, we all make mistakes. Customs examiner probably didn't have that informed compliance publication handy, so they just decided to pull a fast one. Again, it's seems like it's an easy task to put these questions together, but it's really not. It's difficult. So be as it may, keep in mind that even CBP examiners can be wrong, and I think they're wrong on this one. When you apply the methodology which I advocate throughout this classes, and you come to the answer that CBP examiners disagree with on you, and you can't make any sense, it is possible that you are right and they are wrong. On that note, thank you very much. I again overstepped by 45 minutes. I keep on doing that. I'll probably be punished one way or another. So I'm hoping for your guys' grace.